subject for standard 9th standard, and that's true session 1. And the name of the chapter we are going to begin with it is The Language of Chemistry. I repeat once again, the name of the chapter is Language of Chemistry. When I talk about the chemistry, chemistry is a subject. How does the chemistry have its own language? Let me clear you one thing, children. Each and every subject is having its own language. For example, if I take biology, it's having its own language. It has to be written with certain scientific names, right? And I take the example of Hindi. Hindi is also having its own language. If I take the English, English is having its own language, maybe in terms of Greek, Latin, or etc. Now, when I take the subject so-called chemistry, chemistry is having its own language. How come chemistry will be having its own language? We know that chemistry consists of different kinds of elements. Chemistry is made up of only elements. And now at present, 118 elements have been came into the picture, into the periodic table. But the process of research is going on yet, right? But at present, if 118 elements has been discovered, this 118 elements should be written with certain symbols, certain words, right? So that's nothing but called as a language. Now, if you study from LKG to UKG, you should know the fundamental basis of your language. Like if you are studying in LKG, you should know ABCD, 1, 2, 3. That is a basic of that particular subject. Similarly, in chemistry also, there are certain fundamental processes. And this fundamental process begins with the symbolizing the elements. This 118 elements which are there, that has to be symbolized. Suppose if we do not denote those elements with the symbols, how come you will accommodate that 118 element into that short periodic table? You cannot write all the carbon as C-A-R-B-O-N. Full spelling you cannot write. You have to symbolize that carbon with certain alphabet, certain letter. So that's nothing but the symbolization of the element. So that is coming under the language of chemistry. So what is language of chemistry? Language of chemistry is nothing but symbolization of certain element so that that symbolized element can be properly fit into the periodic table. Right? Now, apart from this, why we need to symbolize any element? For example, if I take an example of World Health Organization, if everywhere we cannot say World Health Organization, we have to make it shortcut, we have to make it in an abbreviation form. So directly we say that WHO. Or if I say ICMR, ICMR stands for Indian Council of Medical Research. So that is a short form or abbreviation of ICMR, this Indian Council of Medical Research. Similarly, if carbon is there, if carbon has to be denoted with a certain symbol, I can simply say that carbon is denoted with capital letter C. That's so simple. So that's why this language of chemistry came into the picture. Right? So, we'll start this thing in a more detail now. Now, symbols. What are symbols, dear? Symbols are nothing but it represents the abbreviation. It represents the short form or short part of any word. Right? So, it represents for the full name of the element. If any full name of the element is there, it has to be written in the short letter or abbreviated form. For example, carbon. Now, carbon spelling is C-A-R-B-O-N. This is the word form of carbon. Now, if I want to symbolize that carbon in a short form or abbreviated form, simply what I do, I just write this carbon by denoting C. Right? What I did over here, this carbon first letter C, first alphabet C, I have to write in the form of a capital letter. Right? So that is a symbolization for carbon. Now if I take the nitrogen, instead of writing nitrogen in the periodic table with the spelling N-I-T-R-O-G-E-N, simply I write the abbreviated form of a nitrogen, has capital N. Right? So whenever I am going to symbolize, first or foremost thing is that I have to write the initial alphabet in the form of a capital. Right? So carbon is having an initial letter C. Nitrogen is also having an initial letter N. And that has to be written in the form of a either by writing the capital letter, and there are some cases, we study the cases one by one in detail. So what are the symbols? I think the people understood in that. Now, it is not necessary that each and every element will be having the capital letter. First alphabet has a capital letter, or only one letter will be used as a first alphabet. No, it's not like that. In certain other element, along with the first letter, the second letters are also used. Along with the first letter, the fourth letter are also used. So those are the cases. We need to understand that. Right? So this is just a symbolization. What is the definition of symbols? Symbols are nothing but the abbreviation of the full form of the name of the element. Right? So that is the symbols. Now we'll study these cases in more detail. Now in some cases, first case we'll study. In some cases, first letter of the name of the element is taken as its symbol. In some cases, first letter of that name of the element is used as its symbol, right? So let's take oxygen. Here in oxygen, in this case, only the first letter, only the first alphabet is used as its symbol, right? So this symbol has to be written always with a capital letter, right? So oxygen is denoted with the capital letter O. So this is the first case. I repeat by once again this first case. In some of the elements, first alphabet is used as its symbol. For example, oxygen. Oxygen is having the symbol of O because oxygen starts with the spelling O, X, Y, Z, G, E, N. So here O is used as the oxygen symbol, and that is written with a capital alphabet. When I take the example of sulfur, now sulfur is written with a capital letter S. Right. So this sulfur, S is taken as its symbol. Right. So in this case, some of the elements, you know, the first letter will be used as its symbol, and that first letter has to be written in capital letter. Right. So this is the case, first case. Now in second case, what happens is there. In second case, in some cases, the symbol of the element has a two letter, as I said initially. Not only the first letter is used as a symbol of the element. Along with the first letter, the second letter will be also considered as a symbol. Right? So in some cases, the symbol of the element has two letters. First letter should be capital and the second letter should be written in the small alphabetic form. Right? So first letter should be in the capital form and the second letter immediately after first letter, second letter should be written in the small form. Right? So let's take the example of that kind of an element. Now we'll take an example of cobalt. Cobalt spells as C O B A L T. This is the spelling for cobalt. But according to this case, in cobalt, capital letter is C. First letter is C, and second letter is O. So that becomes a symbol for cobalt, right? So this is the second case where first carbon has to be written with the capital letter. Second letter should be written in the small alphabet. Suppose if you write first as carbon as a capital and second also as a capital, this is considered to be wrong. Always keep in mind, if you are taking first alphabet as a capital, it is necessary to write the second alphabet in the small form. Right? So that is an example for cobalt. Now nickel. Let's take an example of nickel. Nickel spells as N I C K L E. Now here in nickel, N is a capital letter. First letter is N, which you have to write in a capital form. Second alphabet is I. So here you have to write N in the capital form and I in the small form. Right? You are not supposed to write N and I in the capital form. It is absolutely wrong. Right? So in this case, nickel has to be always denoted by N I. right? In first case, what was happening? Only the first letter of that element was considered to be the symbol in some element. In some element, along with the first alphabet, second alphabet is also considered to be the symbol, provided the first alphabet should be written in the capital letter and the second alphabet must be written in the small form. So this is the second case while writing the symbol of any element. Now understand, let us understand this third case. Okay, in some cases the symbols of the element have been derived from the Latin name. In some cases, the element symbols are derived from the Latin name. Instead of writing the capital form, the first letter, the second letter or third letter, here some element has the name origin from the Latin word, right? Latin form, right? For example, let's understand this, sodium, right? Sodium is spelling as, or it spells as S-O-D-I-U-M. This is the spelling for sodium. Now, if we think about sodium, what comes first? Sodium, first alphabet is S. Can I write sodium as a S? Because if I write sodium alphabet, you know, symbol for sodium as S, then one more element is there here, sulfur. If I write so for sodium, if I write S, then what will be the symbol for sulfur? It will be similar. As I said earlier, there is no similar symbol for any two elements or more than two elements. Each and every element is having its own symbol. So sodium is derived from the Latin word. So since the sodium is derived from the Latin word and the name which has been given from the Latin word for the sodium is natrium. I repeat once again, natrium. The Latin name for sodium is natrium. The spelling for natrium is N-A-T-R-I-U-M. So this is the spelling for natrium. Now if it's beginning from N and second alphabet is A, can I write natrium as N? Can I write natrium as N? No. Because already we know for nitrogen N is there. We cannot give sodium as N, though it is beginning from the origin from the Latin word called as natrium. So along with N, what should we have to allot it? Along with N, we have to allot the second alphabet. What is there in the second form? Second letter A. Right? So the symbol for sodium becomes Na. Right? So here the sodium name is what? Natrium. So therefore the symbol for natrium is Na, or sodium is Na. Because sodium is origin from the Latin name natrium. Okay? Now let's take the second example, potassium. Now, potassium is derived from the Latin word we are saying, right? Suppose if I write the potassium as P, the potassium, when the symbol for potassium if I take as P, there is one more element which is existing with a similar symbol P, which is phosphorus. If the phosphorus has been denoted with a P, potassium cannot be denoted with a P because it will become similar, right? So for potassium, the Latin name is what? For potassium, the Latin name is kalium. So we have to take kalium for deriving the name for the symbol for the potassium. Now the spelling for kalium is K-A-L-I-U-M. It spells like that. So if it is beginning with the capital letter K, simply the symbol for potassium will be K. That's so easy. So this is a case where some element has been derived from the Latin word, and according to that Latin word, they are symbolized in that manner. Okay, that is the third case. Now let's understand the fourth case. In fourth case, there are certain elements, as I earlier said, there are 118 elements. As such, still we are knowing about it, but the researchers are going on. Now, if 118 elements are researched now, up till now, the elements whose atomic number is more than 100, let me once again, the elements whose atomic number is more than 100, that time, those elements has to be symbolized with the three letters. Those elements has to be symbolized with three letters. There, one letter, two letter cannot be denoted because their atomic number is more than 100. So the verification should be there for denoting the symbolization of that element. So the element the smaller letter, right? So 1, 2, right? And the third letter which we have to choose over here, after writing U, after writing N, directly you have to write B. You are not supposed to write NILB. Directly U, N, B. So three letters has been assigned for Indian idiom, right? So how the three letters have been assigned for Indian idiom? The first capital letter U, the second after U, N is there. So N you have to write, and then after that directly you have to write B. Now let's take another example, you will understand more in depth, right? Now second example is union trio. Union trio. So here in union trio, how simple will be? The first letter will be U, capital letter U. The second letter will be N, small n. Then shall I write NIL over there? No, we are not supposed to write NIL over there. So directly what should I have to write over here? After writing capital U, small n, directly we have to jump on T. How we have to jump on B? Similarly, we have to jump on T. So these are the, you know, elements which are having atomic number more than 100. So therefore, these elements are exceptional elements and they have to be denoted by three letters. First letter should be capital and another two letters should be written in the short form or small form, not short form, or small form. Right? So these are the example for unidium or three letters for unidium and unidium. So let's recap once again. What we studied here? We studied about the symbol. Now what are symbols? Symbols are nothing but it is an abbreviated form while writing the name of the element. For example, carbon. Carbon has to be abbreviated with capital letter C. Nitrogen has to be abbreviated with capital letter N. Now there are some cases. There are totally four cases. Right? In first case, what it was saying is that always the first alphabet should be written with a capital letter. And here only one capital letter is used as its symbol for the element. For example, oxygen. Oxygen, first letter O has to be written with a capital letter and it becomes the symbol for the oxygen. When I take sulfur, sulfur starts with an S. So S is written in the capital letter and it becomes the symbol for the sulfur. This is the first case where the first alphabet becomes its symbol. Right? Now, in second case, what happens? Along with the first alphabet, the second alphabet is also considered to be the symbol. For example, cobalt. Cobalt starts with a C. So I cannot write C has a symbol for cobalt because already carbon, for example, C is there. So for cobalt, what will happen? CO. Now, second alphabet, two alphabets are there. But the second alphabet you have to write with a small form, a small letter. Similarly, nickel. Nickel starts with an N. So I cannot denote nickel as N alphabet because nitrogen is there, already having the symbol for nitrogen is what? N. So you cannot denote nickel as N. There, along with the N, the second alphabet is becoming its symbol. So nickel, simple as N, I. This was the third, second case. Now in third case, some of the elements have been derived from the Latin word. Right? For example, sodium and potassium. So the sodium name is what? Natrium. Potassium name is barium. So depending upon the Latin word, their symbols are assigned. So sodium name is natrium. So its symbol is Na. I cannot give N for sodium because already nitrogen is there. So therefore, sodium has to be denoted with N capital letter and A small alphabet. Natrium's name will be there for you. Potassium name, Latin word is kalium. Kalium. So here the symbol for potassium becomes K because it is derived from the Latin word kalium. Right? Now, fourth case is that in some cases the elements, those elements who are having more than 100 atomic number, that time rather than using one letter, two letter, here three letters are used or assigned as its symbol. For example, unidium. And second one is unidium. So unidium symbol will be U, N, P. Whereas unitrium symbol will be U, N, T. The topic name for this chapter is valencies. I repeat once again, valencies. Now, for whom we have to learn the valency? The topic is valencies of element. Now, Now, as such, as said, there are 118 elements up till now knowing. So, each and every element is having a symbol. Along with the symbol, they are also assigned or allotted with a valency. Right? So, what is valency is all about? Now, valency of the element is nothing but it is the number of electrons. Repeat, the number of electrons. Here, the game of electrons start. Here, the proton, you know that. Element is made up of atoms, and atoms are made up of proton, neutron, and electron, which you have been already studying from since from 6th standard, right? So here, in valency, the game of electrons will be there, right? So number of electrons, either they have to lose that electrons or gain electrons, or they have to contribute for sharing, right? They have to share the electrons between them. The nearest noble gas configuration, that is to gain its octet complete. I think none of the people did not understood what is nearest gas configuration. You are aware of the word noble gas in periodic table. There is a one period or group with consisting of noble gas element. This element, what they are having is there, they are stable element. Now what is stable? Now we as a human being, we need stability, right? We need stability. Survive in this universe. Stability means what? Basic fundamental requirement, what is necessary to live in this surrounding or environment. We need it, like food, clothing, and shelter. These are the basic things. If any one of them is missing, we will be unstable, right? So here, the elements also need stability. How does the element will gain stability? The element will gain stability by having eight electron octet or is there, means by having eight electrons in its outermost shell. So if any of the element is having eight electrons in its outermost shell, then that element is considered to be the most stable element, right? So if suppose A is an element, in this, if outermost shell is having eight electrons, right? If outermost shell is having eight electrons, this element, A element, is considered to be the most stable element, because its octet is completed, right? So here, valence is nothing but the element. Some of the element will not have 8 electrons in their outermost shell. So what they will do? They will start searching for the excess electron wherein somebody will give them, and then their octet will be completed. Some of the element will be having the more number of electrons in their outermost shell. So those element, they will start losing the electrons to give to someone else, and they will have 8 electrons in their outermost shell. Hook or hook, either they have to lose the electron or they have to gain the electron. But their ultimate goal is that they should possess 8 electron in the outermost shell. It should not be more than 8 electron. So to gain electron configuration nearest to the noble gas, this element should have 8 electron in their outermost shell. So that is a stability property. And this stability property can be gained by losing, gaining, or sharing the electrons between the element, and that's nothing but called as valency. Now let's understand this valency with an example. If an example is given in the picture, you will understand more in detail. Now let's take carbon, right? Carbon, in first in only we study, what is the symbol for carbon? C, right? So the symbol for carbon is C, and the atomic number for carbon is 6, right? So carbon is having symbol C, and the atomic number for carbon is 6. Now if I want to allot the carbon 6 with the 6 atomic number, the distribution of the electrons should be there within the shell, right? So now suppose if this is the carbon, right? This is the carbon. Now carbon has to be allotted with the 6 electrons. Now how you will distribute the electrons within this shell? You should know one formula, and the formula is 2n raised to 2. I repeat once again, 2 into 10 power to 2. This is the formula, right? So here there are shells, K, L, M, L. So there are shells over there, right? So here if you write 2, now N is what? First shell. K is first shell. So I write K as 1, right? So K is belonging to the first shell. So N is the number of shell. N is the number of shell. So if find your writing N as a K, and K is belonging to the first cell. So power 2, this is equal to 2 only. The answer is 2 only, right? So here, in first cell, how many electrons will go? 2 electrons will go. In first cell, 2 electrons are going. Now in second cell, how many did you know in the second cell? Now the formula was as such, the formula was 2 into N raised to 2, right? So second cell is what? L, right? The second cell is L. So second cell is L, second raised to 2. So this will be 2 into 4, this will be 8, right? So 8 electrons should be there in the second cell. But the atomic number for carbon is 6. Already 2 electrons has been inserted into the K cell. The L cell will be consisting of what? 4 electrons, not 8 electrons, 4 electrons. Suppose if I write 8, so 8 plus 2 becomes 10. But the atomic number for carbon is 6. So 2 plus 4 is 6. Right? So this is the formula for allotting the number of electrons in each cell. Now first cell will be consisting of 2 electrons. Second cell will be consisting of 4 electrons. Why 4 electrons? Because the atomic number is 6. Right? So the electronic configuration for carbon is 2, 4. Whereas, when I consider the molecule formation, methane, right? CH4. Now here, one carbon is there, 4 hydrogen is there. One carbon is there, 4 hydrogen is there. So what is the atomic number for hydrogen? 1. So what will be the electronic configuration for hydrogen? Simply 1. Right? So how the molecule will be formed in the methane molecule? Right? Now methane is having the molecular formula. What is the molecular formula for methane? CH4. CH4 means 1 carbon and 4 hydrogen. 1 carbon and 4 hydrogen. So this is methane. Right? So what it is? It is basically methane molecule. Right? Now how was the electronic configuration for carbon? 2, 4, 9. So how many electrons are there in the valence shell? In first cell, 2 electrons. Valence shell means last cell. Last cell for the carbon is this one. Right? So first cell is containing 2 electrons, whereas last cell is containing 4 electrons. So how many electrons are there in the carbon valence shell? 4 electrons. So these are the valence shell electrons of carbon. Right? Whereas hydrogen is having how many electrons? 1 electron. So each hydrogen will be having one electron given. Like this. Right? So yellow color electrons will be of hydrogen. The white color electrons will be of carbon. Right? Now here, as I already said in the beginning, each and every element should have 8 electrons in their outer motion. Then only that element will be the stable element. But in carbon, 4 electrons are there. It requires 4 more electrons to complete an octet. Now from where the carbon will gain the 4 electrons? It has a 4 electron in its outer motion. But how many more electrons it need? It need more 4 electrons to gain 8 electrons in order to complete the octet. So they will gain stability. So here, each carbon atom, each electron will try to share the electrons of the hydrogen. Right? Now hydrogen is having how many electrons over here? Right? See, this hydrogen one electron will try to share with the each carbon. So all these 4 electrons of hydrogen will try to share with carbon. Right? So each electron of hydrogen, these electrons will try to share with the carbon. Therefore, the carbon will be satisfied with the 8 electrons. How many electrons do you see? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, now carbon is having 8 electrons now. Right? So, carbon becomes satisfaction because its octet is completed. So, carbon becomes happy because it is stable now. Now, what about the hydrogen over here? Hydrogen is having 1 electron. It shared with the carbon. It did not give to carbon. It is trying to share with carbon. Right? So, whereas now hydrogen will also try to gain stability. How it will try to gain stability? By taking 1 electron from each carbon. Yes. one electron from each carbon. So hydrogen is having two electrons. Each hydrogen is having two electrons, right? So carbon is satisfied by having 8 electrons in its outer motion. Hydrogen is also becoming happy by having 2 electrons in its outer motion. So their stability is given. So each any element, whether they are octet is complete or duplet is complete, this element is considered to be the stable element. Either they have to have 8 electrons in their outer motion or 2 electrons in their outer motion. Then and there itself, those elements will be stable, right? So this is the example for the molecule of methane. Now methane molecule, see, now what was the valence for carbon? Carbon was having 4 electrons in its outer motion. How much more electrons are needed? 4 more electrons was needed. So therefore, the valency for carbon, so the carbon valency becomes 4. Why it is considered to be 4? Because we need 4 electrons more to complete an octet. Right? Hydrogen valency, this one, or it is considered to be a certain extent neutral also. But it's octet duplet. Duplet, this is octet, this is duplet. I spell it as duplet. This is the spelling for duplet. Right? So its duplet is completed by gaining one more electron from each carbon. Right? So this is an example for the sharing of electron. So what is valence is all about? Valence is nothing but the number of electrons has to be either lose or gained by certain element, or share between the element in order to gain the stability. How come they will gain stability? In order to complete their 8 electrons in their valence state. And that 8 electron state is called as octet state, which has to be compared with the nearest noble gas, which is belonging to the last group of the periodic table.